Hi, I'm Stephanie Becker. I'm the executive director at Amy Biehl Charter High School. We're downtown at 4th and Gold in the old post office building. Our students come from all over the city, and we focus on a mission of scholarship and service. Every month, our students go out and serve the community from 9th grade through 12th. By the time they're seniors, they have created a senior project that focuses on a social justice issue that they feel very passionate about and aligns with their talents. So they go for 100 hours minimum to serve in the community. The capstone project, the thing that they have to show as their final exam, is the digital story. So we're going to show you what their digital story looks like today. Their digital story focuses on their growth. It answers the essential question, how did I change and how did I make a change at the place where they served? It's just a 5-minute story that talks about their transformation and how they've grown through the project, through the mission, and serving their community. We hope you have a great time watching it.
My junior year, Amy Biehl, was unpredictable, to say the least. With COVID running rampant in the community, I was never sure what the future had in store. So when people began asking me what I wanted to do for my senior project or what I wanted to pursue after high school, I had no idea how to answer. I felt like I could barely think a couple days ahead, let alone think about what I'd want to spend my time doing a year from then. So looking for answers to all the questions flying my way, I thought back to what my response would have been when I was a kid, a veterinarian. And I realized that this was still a reasonable answer to give, and it was still something I was very much interested in. So with this, I began looking into various vet clinics and animal shelters, and I eventually secured a spot at Animal Humane New Mexico. After meeting with my then mentor, Catherine, we decided that the department where I'd get the most hands-on experience would be in foster care, so I decided to start there. Although much of my job consisted of cleaning, stocking, filing, and doing dishes or laundry, I loved every minute I spent there. Most of the animals that came in and out of the foster care office were sick or injured, the rest being newly born puppies and kittens who were still at risk due to their age. At the end of the day, my duty was to maintain a clean and safe environment for them, and I was more than happy to do that, whether it be by setting up their temporary kennels, weaning and encouraging them to eat, or simply spending time playing and interacting with them. I noticed pretty quickly that I was one of the youngest volunteers in this department, with many of the others being between 50 and 70, so I found that I was left with the more difficult jobs that required more time and strength. I began taking the initiative as much as I could, knowing that if I didn't, that the responsibility would fall on the vet techs there, who were busy with more urgent and important things. I realized that these small and seemingly insignificant gestures really improved the flow of the office, with things being more organized and accessible. I had the pleasure of working alongside many different veterinary technicians, watching how they worked with each animal while learning about different illnesses and injuries, as well as their treatments. One of my favorite people to work with was Valerie. She allowed me to assist with things like vaccines and general exams, explaining everything as she went and answering any questions I had. Being able to participate with things like this made a big difference for me. I realized just how intriguing veterinary medicine was to me, and that pursuing a future in it after high school was a real possibility. During this time, I began taking a biology dual credit course at CNM to learn more about what I might be studying during college, as well as a few other prerequisites, and I felt like I was in a really good place with my senior project. However, around this time, I also started facing many setbacks between health problems, car troubles, and revamped COVID restrictions. Catherine took on a new job within the organization and could no longer serve as my mentor. The foster care volunteer program as a whole was struggling as well, and was ultimately shut down to resolve staffing issues. Due to all of this, I began falling behind with getting in the hours that I needed. In order to get caught up, I started doing biology and animal-related Zooniverse classifications while I figured out what to do next. Surprisingly, this ended up being a really fun addition to my project. I enjoyed being able to identify and learn about plants and animals on my downtime using this platform and have it count towards my 100 hours. Fortunately, around this time I also turned 18, which meant I could branch out into different departments within the organization. With this, I decided to train in the dog walking program. Throughout this process, I learned a lot about canine behavior, and I was surprised just how much I didn't already know. I learned how to approach very timid and untrusting dogs compared to very hyper or even aggressive dogs, and how to make sure all of them had a safe and exciting experience regardless. During each shift, I walked anywhere from 2 to 8 dogs, each with very different personalities, observing how they interacted with passing people, other dogs, how they were adjusting to their environment, and whether or not they were presenting any potentially concerning health problems. This was one of their only times to be outside of their kennels, so I was honored to be able to make each walk as fun as I could. We were able to walk laps around the beautiful campus and let them run freely off-leash in Peggy's Park. It was easy to make friends with the other dog walkers as I felt very comfortable from the beginning. I was happy to be a part of such a welcoming community. Although my senior year was filled with many setbacks, I have no regrets regarding my senior project. I have loved every minute I've gotten to spend working with local animals in need, and I've gained a plethora of knowledge and experience that I know will be helpful as I continue my education and work towards my goal of becoming a veterinarian, should I choose to do so. I've grown tremendously as a person throughout the year, with improved social skills, work ethic, and a new outlook on life as a whole. I no longer fear the unknown elements of the future, and I feel prepared for any obstacles that may come my way. When we all started making these videos, we were asked to describe not only how we've changed as an individual throughout the year, but the lasting changes we've made in our organizations. At first, I felt as if I hadn't done much of anything to leave a lasting legacy at Animal Humane. I honestly felt like I couldn't make big changes, like I didn't have the authority or capability to do so. But then I looked back at all of the animals I'd met since being there. I had a story for each of them, and knew that I had done something for every one of them that would benefit them in the long term. I may not have made a huge impact on the organization as a whole, but I know that I made an impact on the lives of many animals throughout my time there, and that is something I'm very proud of.
Our story begins in April of 2021. Barely out of lockdown, Cameron must find a senior project to spend the next year with. He decides on the ACLU. Rejected. So he turns his sights to Explora and a political party. Both open. He ghosts one and meets with the other. They're a bunch of weirdos. He quits on them. He applies to the failsafe, the biopark. Rejected. Plans to work directly with a lawyer. Fell through. August comes. No project. And then comes the ray of sunshine, the light at the end of the tunnel, knight in shining armor, Moses himself, Brett Aker. The library, a few blocks away, is looking for volunteers. A fairly smooth interview and general rundown later, I began my senior project with the main library of Albuquerque. Located on Copper Avenue, a short walk from Amy Biehl, the library is a very convenient site for my project. While I did not initially apply, volunteering for a library was indeed always something I considered, just never very seriously. In all honesty, I'd entirely forgotten there was a library so close to the school. But regardless, getting started and figuring out what I was doing was pretty painless. I'd be working pretty much entirely on the bottom floor, the kids/teens section, and once I learned where to find everything and how to read the Dewey Decimal System and just generally where everything was, it was only a matter of doing the hours and doing something more significant. My on-site mentor, Sarah, would ask me if I'd thought of anything pretty regularly, but I kept kicking the can down the road. It wasn't that I didn't want to put effort into a project here, I just genuinely didn't know what I could do to provide for the library. Dual credit classes were something I was comparatively prepared for. Having already taken one over the previous summer, I was ready for college courses and understood what was expected of me regarding them. I took 2 more last semester and 1 more this semester. The most inconvenient part about them was commuting, but that was solved by using the bus in the first semester, and then I had the pumpkin the second semester. My mentor and friends will readily tell you about all the complaining I've done regarding some of my classes and teachers, but I generally think the experience was worth it. Having the credits and understanding all manner of bad teachers is essential for when I go to college. Come only a few weeks into the second semester, Sarah and I had decided on what to do for my project, something to leave a lasting mark. I was to create a book list, a reader advisory of sorts, for people interested in a specific genre, topic, or subject. I decided on something that I was surprised they didn't have, which I knew a decent amount about. Shonen manga. Literally translating to young boy, shonen manga are Japanese comics directed towards kids around 10 to 16 years old. And it took a surprising amount of time to complete this, having to use the resources and prioritize what the library already had regularly slowed my progress. But in the end, I finished the book list, and it now lives tucked away in the corner of the ABQ library website. Seriously, it's a pain to find unless you know when to look for it. But along with its completion, I was able to set up a full display for part of February and March in the teen section, complete with a slideshow providing QR codes and the first volume of my recommended series. And it's hardly a monumental achievement, in my opinion. I don't even think that what I made was particularly good or impressive, but it reinvigorated a sense of true accomplishment I'd been lacking recently. I like to think that I've left something with the main library. While several had come after me, I was the first volunteer at my location, or so I've been told. But did I change? At least meaningfully? I can't really say. I haven't had some great awakening to serving my community, new inspiration on what to do with myself. But I can confidently say that, if nothing else, I had a good time. I hope everyone else did too.
May it please the court, counsel, and members of, well, the audience, I guess I should say. That is how every trial starts, and it is a phrase I have said multiple times as a member of the Amy Biehl mock trial team. I have been a member of this family since my freshman year. I have tackled everything from being a witness to an attorney and team captain. This year, I was honored to be the assistant coach. My name is Adrian Chavez, and this is my senior project story. I was no longer a student. I was someone who the other students were going to look up to for help and support throughout the year. But as soon as the first day started, I knew I was going to enjoy myself. We began studying the case we had 2 years ago, which was Hemingway versus the state of New Mexico. We then got to practice playing some roles. It was fun taking on the teacher role. It was something new for me, but I grew new ways of interacting with the students, and it gave me some new ways of thinking about mock trial as well. The next step was receiving the new case, Marmalade versus the state of New Mexico, which was another murder case. The students, again, were excited about this one. They were immediately invested in the facts and wanted to get working. Once we assigned the roles for each person, we began creating freshly new material. This was when the fun began. Jeff Buckles, my mentor, has been my mock trial coach all 4 years I've been at Amy Biehl. I have learned so much from him. He has not only taught me more about how to be a better mock trial student, but also how to be a better leader in general. This year, as his assistant coach, he has shown me how to be someone that can effectively run a classroom and gain the students' respect and trust as a coach. I also had a second mentor. Caroline has been with mock trial for 2 years now and has helped Jeff and I with all the technical things for the competition. She is also my advisor, and if I'm being honest, I don't know where I would be without her support throughout these last 2 years. If it was not for these two great mentors, I don't think I would be in mock trial today or have the skills that I have built throughout my high school career. I wanted to create a PowerPoint lecture for both lawyers and witnesses that would hopefully help them understand the necessity of characterization in mock trial. For this project, I was inspired by the Kyle Rittenhouse case that was taking place during the time. I used examples from that case and showed the students how certain people act within a courtroom environment. I've always had a passion for writing in law. I've always known that I wanted to pursue this going into college and as a career because of mock trial. But I never really saw teaching as a possible career path before I started my senior project. Seeing my students excel and reach new heights because of mock trial has inspired me so much. I love seeing their faces when they begin to understand something new. There's just a warm feeling in my heart seeing them perform and acquire new knowledge that will benefit them in the future. Having the experience of coaching this year has given me a new passion to pursue, and that is teaching high school English. Mock trial was not the only reason I knew I wanted to pursue a career in law and as an English teacher. The dual credit courses that I have taken have also helped me with realizing my passions. I started taking CNM courses my sophomore year. I started off by taking a public speaking class, which furthered my skills as a public speaker. For my senior year, I took college algebra and Comp 2. Composition 2 has to be my favorite class that I have taken this year because of the great skills I have acquired as a writer. It was a great learning environment and I liked working with all my classmates. The final step for mock trial was competition. When the results came out, I was screaming in my room because of how excited I was. The varsity team placed 5th, which meant they were going off to state competition. This group of students are going to be the next lawyers, presidents, artists, and activists. To me, they are my heroes. I have learned so much from them, and hopefully they have taken something from me as well. They will always be a part of my journey. I have them to thank for everything I am striving to be.
This is Raphael Signet, an up-and-coming senior citizen and a student currently attending his 4th year at Amy Biehl High School. Little do you know, during that year, he'd been secretly working on a project at both Mountain Mahogany and UNM in a ploy to help and learn from these sites. Raphael's history with Mountain Mahogany begins 12 years ago, when he went undercover as a first grader. There, he met his mentor, Miss Khanna, and when looking for a project site, his prior experience there, as well as who his mentor would be, had made Mountain Mahogany an excellent fit. His role this time was to aid the teacher, the classroom, and the students. He made an online format for all the students to be able to post their ideas in an organized manner, which became something that was used often in future lessons. Soon after, Raphael was approached with the opportunity to become an assistant coach on the cross-country team. Hesitant at first, he accepted. This was a turning point for Raphael, both the experience being an assistant coach and because it inspired him to do something like that again once the season was over. After some brainstorming, arts would inspire Raphael's next venture. Throughout the process of making this a reality, Raphael learned important lessons about self-advocacy. Furthermore, he felt less nervous around other faculty, igniting more confidence within him that followed him even outside of his sight. With the assistance of his mentor, Miss Khanna, an after-school art class came to fruition. You see, Raphael had been in attendance of a CNM drawing class undercover as a sophomore in college. The professor was unaware of Raphael's status as a dual credit student, and when he told her that he wasn't a freshman, it solidified his disguise as a sophomore. Thankfully, his incredible disguise did not affect his learning. This was important, as what he learned would be what those who joined his class learned, but there was still a problem. Raphael's college art classes were 3 hours twice a week, and the ones he taught were 1 hour once a week. Short on time, he began by teaching the students what helped him the most. As a student, he knows that everybody learns differently, but being the instructor provided a new perspective. This helped him realize that teaching the students what helped him may not help the students in the same way. His next solution was to let the students decide what they learn. He would show them what he had done in class, and the students would pick what they believed to be the most important to them.
This ended up working out, and now Raphael knew what to teach, but he didn't know how to teach. The first thing he learned was that teaching is hard. If everyone learns differently, then everyone will be taught differently. So the students picked what they wanted to learn, Raphael gave the assignment, emphasized key points, and went around to each student making sure they understood. Thankfully, his class was small, so he could effectively accomplish this in the time he had. In the end, every student did great and got to spend time practicing drawing. And the best way to get better at drawing is to spend time drawing. Everyone was grateful, kind, and Rafa the Mastermind was never suspected of his plan for even a second. Halfway through the first semester, Raphael had the opportunity to attend a stable isotopes lab with UNM. After the stable isotopes lab, Raphael and two of his peers decided they'd like to explore stable isotopes further. With the guidance of Michaela, their unofficial mentor, they began to work with whale baleen. First, they would mark the whale baleen in increments of 1 centimeter, starting from the gum. Then, take a Dremel, grinding the keratin into dust along each marking. The dust was then collected in small containers and was ready to be weighed. Taking the grinded keratin from the capsules and transferring it into tiny tin capsules, trying to get in between 0.5 milligrams and 0.6 milligrams when weighed. After that, you would fold the capsule in on itself, and from there it was in the hands of the researchers. The researchers loaded the samples into a mass spectrometer, which would measure the amount of stable carbon and nitrogen isotopes in the sample, revealing the whale's diet. The exposure to that environment is what was most valuable. Working and talking with a college student so regularly gave lots of insight into what college life was like. Being at the college and working in the labs inspired ideas for Raphael's future as well. Now, at the end of his senior year, Raphael sits talking to himself in the third person, telling you the story of what he believes to be the origins of Batman.
My name is Ilani Ortiz, and this is me crying a year ago because I had no idea what I was doing and what senior year had for me. I just let everything fall into place and see what happens, which led me to the Bernalillo County Animal Care and Resource Center. You see, I have always loved animals, and I knew I was going to grow up to be someone around animals. Since I was able to write and answer the question, "What do you want to do when you grow up?" I have always answered, "Veterinarian." The first time I walked into Bernalillo County Animal Care and Resource Center, I was given a tour around the facility, and the outreach manager, Candace, told me that my eyes brightened up when I first laid my eyes inside the clinic they had there. I immediately knew that I found my place and I was pointing in the right direction. This hasn't always been the case though. In my freshman year, I was very confused on whether or not I wanted to be a veterinarian or even want to pursue anything with animals. I got myself really into music. I sang, played the ukulele, the piano, and I wrote some songs. Along the way, I felt like I lost myself. Music didn't make me feel as content as I thought it did. I was insecure, and it got to the point where I felt like I was forcing myself to do it. I love music, and I always will, but it wasn't for me. This is clear to me now because I don't feel that way when I'm working with animals. I found my confidence. It's not a chore to me. Being with the animals has become my happy place, except when I have to clean their poop. My senior project mentor, Jolene Hewitt, the volunteer coordinator, also known as the person who makes the cleanup poop, has been so helpful and supported me since day one. She has granted me so many opportunities and has helped me boost up my confidence when it comes to talking to other people or handling a cat or dog. She has taught me so much this year and I'm so grateful. I'm so lucky to have been able to be her guinea pig when it comes to new training videos and other things. I have a bigger role at Bernalillo County Animal Care and Resource Center than Jolene's guinea pig. I help out with event planning, medical assistance, socializing cats and dogs, walking dogs, cleaning kennels, customer service, and leading volunteer groups from Amy Biehl High School. I do recovery in the clinic, waking up the animals post-surgery, and taking the intubation tube out of their mouth. Sometimes I get to clean up the clinic post-surgery. When socializing dogs and cats, it gets them more comfortable around people and becomes great pets for future families. Interacting with dogs and cats, I share my experience with people looking for a pet so they can find a pet that will be a perfect with their personality. Leading the volunteer groups from Amy Biehl High School has inspired more students to volunteer for their senior project, and the volunteer groups help out a lot while they're there. I created a legacy. Doing all this work and connecting with the staff and other volunteers led me to be their Volunteer of the Month in February. Being in an environment where I get to work around things I love most has changed me for the better. I have become more motivated to work harder in school, become more outgoing, and have been good company for the homeless pets there. My work at Bernalillo County Animal Care and Resource Center has been my favorite accomplishment, but it's not the only one. I took two classes at CNM this year. I took Intro to Pop Culture and American Sign Language 1. I took these classes to be ahead in college credit. I'll be a semester ahead once I enter college, and this will put me one step closer to becoming a zoo conservationist. Taking these classes meant more in the end. American pop culture helped me improve my writing and comprehension skills, and sign language not only helped me in basic communication in a new language, it opened my eyes to the deaf community's history. Speaking of language, this year I also worked on my bilingual seal. It was a lot of work, but in the end, it was totally worth it. I learned a lot about myself throughout this project, and it strengthened my Spanish-speaking skills a lot. I did so much this year, and it's been the best year for me. I became Student Council Vice President and did events for the school, completed 21 college credits, became Volunteer of the Month at Bernalillo County Animal Care and Resource Center, finished my bilingual seal, and almost got promoted at Sonic. I couldn't accomplish these milestones without my family, my friends, the senior team, my mentor Michelle, my senior project mentor Jolene, and my dog Flash.
I knew what I needed to do from the beginning. I owe this to my belief of reincarnation. In another life, my cells collided with millions of different atoms, and I became the entirety of the ocean, the whole being that effortlessly flowed together. The light at the end of the tunnel was the stars deciding I needed to become something different. The seafoam, the starfish, the bright coral still exist within my veins, which is why when I picked up my very first ocean book, I was staring at home my soul so desperately missed. Living in New Mexico, the only water I got close to was the swimming pool, so I collected every ocean paraphernalia my little hands could grab. I have books, teeth, stuffed animals, figurines, shirts, necklaces, and bracelets. I memorized shark facts as if they were verses from the Bible. But the last few pages of each book ended the same. The oceans were dying, so when teachers or friends asked what I wanted to be, it was like my mouth knew exactly what to say. Marine biologist. When I was accepted into the volunteer program with the Biopark Aquarium, I was ecstatic. During the summer reminded me of camp. My favorite parts had live interactions like holding spiders, dissecting frogs, and getting a tour above the shark tank. I especially enjoyed looking at all the unique shells and shark teeth. After summer ended and school started, the work changed to minor but still important tasks. For example, I organized, I cleaned, I made maps, and I did a lot of folding brochures. I also got closer to my mentor, Deborah. She was beyond helpful and understanding, and her colleagues, Fred and Rebecca, are fun and laid back. Although the tasks were mundane, it was always fun with them. Walking around the gardens kept me passionate and energetic about what I wanted to do. The vibrancy of the plants made me feel at peace and inspired to make my own flourishing world. And I needed this boost, especially after last year. For a long time, I felt demoralized and disheartened. I felt as if there were too many problems to fix, so why should I bother? The mindset was an endless cycle of wanting to give up. So I wanted to try and get out of the rut by reigniting a passion, learning. I took a Spanish class to try to connect with my culture, and I felt really distant from the culture. But online language courses aren't the best. But for my second class, I took biology. While the first semester I failed, I learned three very important lessons. It felt good to take responsibility, especially when my biggest fear growing up was being responsible for myself and my actions. Also, despite failing, I learned how important a solid support system is, especially with my mental health. And lastly, I didn't berate myself and instead used this as an opportunity to do better and to learn.
I am so beyond grateful for the opportunity that was given to me, and I learned so much. I just want to say thank you to my mentor, my teachers, my friends, and especially my mom.
Hey there. I hope you're sitting tight with some popcorn and a drink, because I'm going to tell you the story of my senior project at the LGBTQ Resource Center.
My journey with the LGBTQ Resource Center started the summer of 2020. My friend's mom got a new job at the Diversity and Equity Division at UNM, a department that works closely with the LGBTQ Center. I was invited to come along to a meet and greet that they were throwing. I felt an instant connection with the space upon seeing it for the first time, even though they had barely opened after months of being on lockdown. It might sound a little odd, but the thing I fell in love with the most about the Resource Center is the little library made up of hundreds of books by queer authors, ranging from history to theory to poetry. That to me was one of the most valuable resources that they could offer. I have spent a good portion of my time at the LGBTQ Center making buttons for them. And honestly, they come out pretty good. I've probably made enough pronoun pins for a small army. I guess that it's about time I introduce you to the team. This is Trey, who comes from Empower every week to collaborate with the LGBTQ Center to provide free and confidential HIV testing. This is Biko. They've been working at the LGBTQ Center for most of their grad and undergraduate schoolings. This is Josh. They do all of the graphic designing for the Resource Center. And I didn't have a video of our beloved director and boss, Frankie, so here's a picture of Pico in a Frankie mask. For the past few months, I have been working on an orientation for queer and trans high schoolers that are prospective UNM students. We had a pretty small turnout, but in retrospect, I think that was for the best. Another student and I got a very personalized tour of UNM, and I saw a lot of parts of campus that I hadn't seen before. Josh even designed these super cute t-shirts for our event. I literally took like three of them, but don't tell Frankie that. The Resource Center can be whatever you need it to be. Whether you're looking for a study spot, moral support, or community, it can be a pretty silly environment. But we also deal with a variety of more serious issues on a daily basis. Spaces like the Resource Center are vitally important to students. Although acceptance of queerness is becoming more normalized, many LGBTQ college students are on their own, with minimal support from their families. According to a study conducted by Purdue University, 31.8% of queer spectrum students reported that depression impacted their academics, compared to 14% of heterosexual students. 28.4% of queer spectrum students reported that they had considered dropping out of college, compared to 16% of heterosexual students. And 37.8% of trans spectrum students reported that they had considered dropping out of college, compared to 17.9% of cisgender students. The disparities in resources are very clear, and it goes to show that there is always more that collegiate institutions can do to help trans and queer students succeed academically and feel safer and happier on campus. Regardless of identity, everybody who seeks higher education should have access to it. And once they are there, they should be provided with the resources to finish what they started. Holding space for queer scholars is essential to our academic journeys. This semester, for my dual credit class, I took Intro to American Pop Culture. I like to think of Black culture as the heart of American pop culture and queer culture as the veins. Not a day went by at my senior project that some obscure popular culture reference was mentioned. Though diverse queer media is only starting to be made, many facets of American pop culture have been a source of comfort, connection, and signaling for people in the LGBTQ community. Doing my senior project at the Resource Center provided me with experiences that shifted my perspective on the future. I learned things that will help me push in the direction of my passions as opposed to where others expect me to be. I learned that in order to see change, you have to be the change. Though, I think the most important thing that I learned from my mentor, Frankie, is sometimes the most important resource you can provide is an empathetic ear.
And I'm honestly infinitely glad that I know about the Resource Center, because now I'll always have a place to go.
Hi, my name is Jack. I am a student at Amy Biehl High School, and this is my digital story.
With that out of the way, let's talk about art.
Okay, 3, 2, 1, it's jam.
My whole life, I've been an artist. Since I could first hold a marker, I've been making masterpieces. Art has become a part of my self-expression and my identity, and now, I'd like to appease the capitalist overlords and turn it into a career. For my senior project, I did concept art for Zia Pelta Games. For those who don't know what concept art is, allow me to explain. It's where you take concepts and turn them into art. Sort of like the first draft of an essay, but with drawings. I got to draw characters for their upcoming game, Six Winners. I was honored that my mentor, Phil, would let me work on his game with him. Essentially, I would draw whatever ideas Phil had. Then, we'd take whatever chaos I gave him and use that as inspiration for the cards and what types of powers the characters would have in the game. After that, I would playtest with Alana, Phil's daughter. We always had so much fun goofing off while playing Six Winners. The playtest went really well. Phil, Alana, and I all had really good synergy, and we would always bounce ideas off of each other on how to make the game better or the characters better. Seeing my art in the cards also really helped to motivate and inspire me. Playtesting and collaborating with Phil and Alana was easily the best part of my senior project. Actually doing the art, on the other hand, got to be a little more difficult. Character design is hard. It's really hard. The whole point is to create something that is iconic, unique, and recognizable. It's all about presentation and being able to spot the character in a crowd. So how do I do that with my designs? For some characters, it was really easy, and I had a clear idea, and I was inspired. Other characters, not so much. It got kind of hard when I had no idea what to do with them. Nothing looked right, and it didn't feel like I was drawing the actual character. Phil, on the other hand, was always really happy and supportive of my art, even though I want to go back and revise some of the characters, he seems to really like a lot of them. Alana had already drawn some references for the characters, so I used those for inspiration. We also had a Google Doc that we just filled with ideas for all of the characters. The one character that I had full creative liberty on was Lucia, and I'm really proud of how she turned out. Creative process is actually really difficult. Art doesn't just magically materialize anytime I'm around a tablet pen. It takes work and it takes patience. I held myself to an insanely high standard, and the pressure always got to me. On top of that, keeping up with school was also pretty difficult, and so I was just crushed by the expectations. A lot of emphasis was placed on the hours that I spent drawing and not enough emphasis on what I was creating. I experienced severe burnout and imposter syndrome because of this. I didn't feel like my art was good enough. I took an art dual credit in hopes of improving my art a little bit, but the teacher was condescending and would often tell me that my art was wrong with no further explanation, which, I mean, understandably was not really helpful. Some of the assignments did push me out of my comfort zone, but none of them were really helpful for what I was trying to do. Working for Phil was great. He's supportive of all my ideas and he listens to me, and he treats me as an equal instead of just some high school student. I learned that game design is all about trial and error, and that mistakes aren't necessarily a bad thing. I kind of already knew that, but it's hard to comprehend. My gut reaction to my mistakes is to hate them, but that's not Phil's. It's more like Bob Ross. He accepts that they happen and that they're a learning experience. When he asked for critiques on the game mechanics, he meant it. He never deflected anything. If we had a problem with the game mechanics, then he would listen to us and change it for the next playtest. He never tried to convince us to appreciate something that we didn't initially like. He never said, oh, that's just how the game is supposed to go. He actually took our advice. Phil's ability to accept critiques is so inspiring to me, and it really helped with my artistic process. I was given a lot of creative liberty when it came to designing the characters, and so I wanted to add LGBTQ and racial representation, because that's really important to me. The characters were already really diverse thanks to Alana, but they let me add on top of that. Even simple things like making a character non-binary or gender fluid can go a really long way. I'm really happy that I got to be a part of this change, and even though some of the representation isn't as obvious as I would have hoped, it's still nice to make a difference. This experience has really opened up my eyes to my flaws as a person. I'm really bad at time management and I burn myself out really easily. But now that I'm aware of them, I can start working to be better. I'd like to thank Phil for letting me work on Six Wingers with him. This experience has been incredible and I wouldn't change a thing. So, thank you.
In the state of New Mexico, approximately 1,190 people are forced to sell sex on a daily basis. My name is Luna Williams, and for my senior project, I chose to work with StreetSafe, a nonprofit organization dedicated to providing harm reduction care to women on the streets of Albuquerque. Growing up in Albuquerque, New Mexico, you see homelessness everywhere. It's always bothered me, so I knew that for my senior project, I wanted to find an organization working with people on the streets. I began my senior project at New Mexico Dream Center, doing outreach along Central on Friday nights and helping out at their drop-in center for kids in need of a safe place to go. I enjoyed my time there, but it didn't feel like the right fit for me. One day when I was expressing this to my dad, he told me about StreetSafe, an organization he had worked with during his time at Healthcare for the Homeless. I reached out, and after working with them for a few weeks, I felt in my element. I attend StreetSafe's evening outreach every week at the corner of Chico and Charleston, in the heart of the war zone. Out of the women we serve, 79 to 86% are victims of sex trafficking, and most are homeless. At our outreach, we give out clothes and supplies. As well as chocolate. And handheld weapons such as pepper spray. Lastly, we give out our bad guy list. We also help women on individual levels with housing and personal issues. After doing outreach for many months, I've made connections with some of our clients and volunteers, as well as the founders Christine Barber and Cindy Aramijo.
Yeah, keep going for some unknown reason.
Women on the streets are constantly dehumanized by society because of what they must do to survive. Most of the women we work with are victims of sex trafficking, and as a result of the trauma they have experienced on the street, they struggle with addiction and mental health issues. The dehumanization of women in the sex trade justifies the violence and discrimination they face. 91% of the women of streets of Albuquerque identify as women of color, and 80% were born in New Mexico. This is no coincidence, this is a social justice issue. One of the main causes of death for women we work with is murder. The women we serve constantly see and experience violence, usually at the hands of men and police officers. In order to keep the women aware of what to look out for in the area, we collect reports of attacks and post them weekly on our bad guy list, which we hand out every Friday at Outreach. Sometimes the work we do becomes overwhelming and disappointing. It's hard to learn the truth about what people are up against, and even harder to fight back against systems of oppression in place. I have been studying some of this material in my sociology classes at CNM, and I think in college I want to continue taking sociology classes and doing street work because I'm truly passionate about doing harm reduction work. Over my time at StreetSafe, I have developed the skill of being able to recognize who's being trafficked and who is not, just by observing what they're wearing, their demeanor, and by the things they take at our outreach. Something I bring to StreetSafe is the perspective of a young person. When I see a woman at outreach that is potentially being trafficked, I usually am the one who goes and tries to talk to them because they're more likely to feel talking to someone around the same age as them. I have also spent a lot of time sorting through donations at StreetSafe's warehouse, which is a never-ending process but usually a fun time. Working with StreetSafe has been a life-changing experience that has set me on the right path for my future. It has given me purpose, community, and perspective. It's changed me for the better and taught me more than I could have imagined. I want to use what I've learned from this experience to pursue a career in social justice. I'm so thankful that I was able to learn what I have, and I'm excited to see what I will be able to do with these skills and knowledge in the future.
Attention on deck. This is Joe Petty Officer McDaniel, and he's the leadership instructor at Garfield Middle School. Doc retired from the military as a Navy medic connected to a Marine battalion. He is an intelligent and hardworking man with grit like none other. My name is Nicholas Cummings, and I'm now a senior at Amy Biehl High School. I'm currently volunteering alongside my old teacher, friend, and now mentor for my senior project at Garfield Middle School's leadership program. My relationship with Doc began my eighth grade year. The biggest competition he coached me for was Sea Perch. We set a middle school speed record, and we were sent to Boston for the national Sea Perch competition. Traveling outside of school for a competition showed me the funny side of Doc, who's always taking goofy selfies for you to find later. My first day at Garfield, I was tasked with teaching our cadets how to make an engineering notebook for the Team Area Rocket Challenge. After my first day of assisting, I knew I was right where I needed to be for my senior project. Next, we had to prepare the kids for the Raider Challenge. This competition is a 1.5-mile long obstacle course run by a team of cadets. The cadets have to work together to complete the tasks and get all the supplies to the evacuation point. The Raider Challenge tests the endurance of the team of six, as well as their communication skills. Training started out as relentless conditioning. The kids became physically fit and were eager to run the course, beating their fastest time. One student stepped up, taking lead and motivating the team. Leadership is not a position, it is an action. She took control and made sure everyone's strengths were utilized. That day, our cadets ran the fastest time, and she was the first of our cadets to receive an officer's rank. I started making friendly competitions amongst the kids to gain their focus. I created a mini challenge that if they beat my archery score, I would do 25 push-ups. Well, I must have done over 100 push-ups that day. Not only were they getting better at archery, but they were learning a new discipline. The young girl putting leaves in my hair was the sister to my childhood best friend. I used to play baseball with her older brother Lorenzo. He invited me to his birthday party at Roller King once, and I remember seeing he had lots of younger siblings. One of the younger girls in a car seat was the very sister I am teaching now. Lolo was shot and killed at a house party this past year on Halloween. Since her brother was a victim of a violent murder with a firearm, she did not want to stick around for the 21-gun salute. Just seeing the guns being loaded caused a wave of insecurity to cover her. Seeing this, Doc sent me on a walk with her, so I let her play with my hair, and we had a wee fight to distract her from the gunshots that afternoon. I have changed this program in many positive ways. I have helped the students create their sea perch designs, making them look more professional, while taking some projects home and secured the electrical cables. I was anxious to pass down my knowledge and love for engineering while sharing many of my mistakes with my cadets. I've also helped my cadets strive for goals they thought were unreachable. A team of two hardly worked on their ROV before the competition. They preferred to go play football and hide in the bathroom. The day of the competition, they left no interview question unanswered, which impressed the judges. They had fantastic communication and set a new middle school speed record. These boys earned their spot in the 2022 National Sea Perch Competition in Washington, D.C. This project has changed me in many ways as well. Through my time as a teacher, I've realized that I was really a student. I learned something new about these children every day, as well as something about myself. I learned that no matter how much you want perfection, too much pressure can cause someone to crack. Helping from a distance might lead to more mistakes, but the journey to reach the goal is much more valuable. For my dual credit classes, I was able to use what I learned from public speaking and taught my cadets how to present to the judges for the Sea Perch competition. I've had more time dedication to the senior project than I ever did with my dual credit classes, but I've learned how to manage this increased workload and enjoy the time giving back to my community. As one special mentor once taught me, each one, teach one.
Thanks so much for watching. You should know that the last two were scholarship winners, then they won money towards their college endeavors, which is really exciting. Also, if you're interested in partnering with us in a collaborative social justice project, or you have a great project that you'd like for students to work with you on, please contact us at amybiehlhighschool.org. Our community engagement director is Brett Aker, and he'd be really happy to talk to you. If you have a student who'd like to come visit, also check out our website and come on down for a tour. We'd love to see you. Have a great day.